Tell me about your father's family, his origins.
Well, his origins are very humble. Generations and generations of very poor peasants, peasants of Georgia, which means Asian people, though Christian, Asian Christians for 15 centuries, like Armenians. Only his father became a worker, a cobbler on the factory. His mother was purely peasant woman with strong faith, peasant woman. And I think he always had this something of that peasant background, which wasn't his character, certain strength, certain rigidity, certain conservatism, and tremendous love for nature and land and fresh air.
What was his mother like? Because I think that there is some... You met his mother, didn't you? And you noticed a resemblance. What was the character?
I was brought to see her when I was a girl of 8, and my brother was 12. We didn't speak Georgian, she didn't speak Russian. There were translators around. She was old, gray-haired, with bright, light eyes, kind of, her eyes were light, freckled, and she was crying and tears were streaming on her face because she was happy to see us, her grandchildren, and she was stretching on the plate some candies to us, and that was the only communication between us which was possible because we couldn't really utter anything satisfactory, but she was pleased to see us. That was the only time I saw her.
What do you think that your father's childhood was like with his mother and father?
Well, as it is known, and as he used to talk about it, it was rather... it was rather horrid, childhood of poverty, with father who was a drunk, who used to beat the rest of the household, mother and himself, and the boy, when he grew up a little bit into teenage, he used to protect mother, and one time even threw the knife at his father in protecting, so it was pretty wild, and then he had to run away and was hit by the neighbors from the furious father. It was pretty rough childhood. However, he used to say that he loved his mother always, who used to beat him too. He admitted that, but that didn't obviously make any difference. He kept certain reverence and really very sincere admiration to her and to her character until his late years.
What about your father's training as in the priesthood? Can you tell us about that?
When we sort of revisited Russia 3 years ago with my teenage American daughter, we went to see that little shack where he was born, and then we went to see the school, the classroom, with crude wooden desks where he sat. And my daughter asked how many languages he had to study, because she was at that time facing the problem of too many languages at once. And they told her that he had immediately, of course, everybody in Georgia, they had to know Russian, they had to study Russian, and he had also Latin and Greek in his parochial school. He was a good student. His favorite subject was, as he himself admitted, was mathematics. Not humanities, as a matter of fact, but mathematics. And then when he was in a seminary, at one time he worked at the astronomical observatory. He worked in some kind of capacity of writing down observations and something like that. He was a good student, as as we know.
Why did he give up the priesthood? What do you think the priesthood had meant to him? Was it important to him later on?
I don't know how was it important when he was young. He never talked about that to me. He dropped out from the seminary, I believe, because of his other involvement in the revolutionary work and struggle, and that meant, of course, total change of philosophy.
Do you know why he became a revolutionary? Did he ever talk about it?
No. You have to understand that we were not a family where, like in Western way, parents talk very much to children and confide to them all about themselves. In fact, I have to go back to very early years when I saw my father more. When I was a teenager, or during the war, or before the war. When I was an adult, we saw each other extremely seldom, and there was very little of this reminiscence kind of a thing. Georgia at that time was, although on the outskirts, was a place of quite a revolutionary ferment, and Social Democratic Party and social democracy was very popular, taking the minds of educated students and from all classes. It always begins with the nobility and then comes to lower classes. And many Russian revolutionaries were in exile in the Caucasus, and of course they brought this, they brought Marxism in. So I think he simply answered to what was rather very typical there. It was a sign of the time.
You've said that you weren't like a Western family that reminisces, but did he ever talk to you, for instance, about his early relationship with Lenin, about what he did in the revolution?
No, he didn't touch that subject at all. I know my mother's family, the Alliluyevs, who were older revolutionaries. They were, in fact, my mother's parents knew my father since the 90s, and before my mother was even born. And they knew Lenin. They would mention once in a while him that... he was an intellectual, he was very intelligent, very polite gentleman.
Can you remember your first Red Square parade as a child?
I don't know if it was the first one. Maybe I was taken before. I suspect I was taken at the earliest age, because that was the habit, take all children there. The one I remember was 1932, because a few days later mother died, and we were there at the parade just before that, and my brother and the grandmother, and it was fun parade. And
how did life change after your mother died? Have you got any memories of that?
Well, for us children, it was really an end of an era when she died. I was 6 and a half, my brother was 11 and a half, and he certainly took it with greater pain than I. And it was total change for us. Our teachers were fired, our home studies and all that schooling and education, which mother was so concerned about, all that ended. Then soon I went to school, to regular school. Then another governess was hired, which was nothing of those whom mother used to find. And then in later few years, all her sisters and brothers, you know, all Alleluyevs, relatives, aunts and uncles, so much beloved, they all disappeared and were sort of banned from house. So her Her departure from our life was really devastating for us, and I wouldn't hesitate to say that it was also devastating for my father, too.
Does your father, do you think, in retrospect, because I know it wasn't apparent at the time, but do you think your father bore any responsibility for her suicide?
I don't think he ever thought that way. He never talked, for many years, he never talked about it to me while I was too young. Prior to his death, when I was already in my 20s, he started referring to her. In his biography, which official biography published in 1949, she was finally mentioned officially as a friend, as wife and close friend, which was quite a step forward because she was just not mentioned at all, as if she didn't exist in the years prior to that. So obviously that was his attitude, otherwise they wouldn't do it. And he obviously wanted to talk about it, because he would start talking about that little pistol that her brother Paul brought to her, obviously for self-protection, kind of a, he couldn't make a better gift, sort of. He was talking about that. He would mention the book, Green Hat, The Green Hat by Michael Arlen, which she read not long before that. He obviously tried to understand. He tried to figure out how it happened. He obviously was himself a person of great self-control and a not emotional person who couldn't do things like that himself. And she was more of artistic nature, more emotional, more bound to be in the moods of this and that. And in any case, I think he somehow tried to cope with it and tried to understand her in the later years.
Why? What happened with the outbreak of war? Let's go to that point and see what. First of all, I suppose perhaps chronologically, I should ask you. When did you start to realize that people were going missing whom you knew?
Well, that was in the 30s. That was, of course, 38, 37, 36, because in our family, our uncles and aunts, they were the first who disappeared. I, as a child, I could see them missing, my aunt's husband. Aunt and Uncle Svanidze, both of them disappeared from sight. Then later, closer to the war time, when the war was already broke in Europe, then uncles and aunts were, even grandmother, they were banned from coming and visiting us in father's apartment in Kremlin. So that was an entirely different atmosphere, and the old servant, the real housekeeper of the house, who was a German from Riga, hired by my mother, a lovely woman, Karolina Thiel, was fired, and a younger person was brought in by KGB. She happened to be the relative of Beria, Beria's wife, you know, cousin of Beria's wife, kind of young woman, KGB sort of informer, shall we say, and had some rank in KGB, a major or a lieutenant or something. And all the cooks and servants were attested, had military ranks in KGB. So that militarization happened on the eve of war.
Do you remember the outbreak of war?
Well, I remember it in rather what happened domestically to us, because we were all sent out of Moscow to first south to the Black Sea and then to Kuibyshev, to that town on Volga, where later the government moved, and it was like the wartime capital. The capital was moved to Kuibyshev. And, of course, my brothers immediately were in the army. My younger brother was in the Air Force, and my older brother was artillery officer, and he immediately left for war. So it was pretty visible. The war was pretty visibly there.
There are stories, and I don't know whether they're true, perhaps you know, about your father wondering whether to leave Moscow. Do you know?
In the fall 1941, when German army was very near to Moscow, actually in the outskirts, I think some motorcyclists were actually in the outskirts, there was a plan of moving the government to Kuibyshev, and places were prepared and residences were prepared, and I saw those, and big bomb called Bomba
shelters
were prepared there too. But then, well, my father changed his mind and stayed, and one of the servants who worked then for him told about that, her story. She had to bring, to serve food, you know. They used to bring food on heavy trays, which were not brought like that, as it is done usually, but they were bringing it on one hand like that, rather gracefully. So she had to run with these trays of food between the house where was the kitchen and the little cottage where he used to stay, not the major house, not the main house, and the shelling from the anti-aircraft was dropping down, and she was running under that because the anti-aircraft artillery was shooting all the time at this time. So she came in with that tray of food, and he asked her, well, is it, are you afraid to be there? And she said, no, Comrade Stalin, we are not afraid. And he said, well, shooting there. Well, she said, it's all right, sort of. And they were all prepared to move. All the kitchen and everything was packed, and the household was packed. Actually, the train was on the rails already to pack it all and move. And within half an hour, he called his chief bodyguards or whomever, I don't know, and said, we're not going, we're staying. And so they decided to stay, and then there was decision to have parade on the Red Square, and there was a parade, of course, which had great impact on the troops. I know people who were on the Red Square. In fact, there were very good poetry of some wartime poets. And then there was that usual gathering in the bomb shelter with speech and so on. And then the counteroffensive was started. And obviously, it was a crucial moment, because if the government would leave, then things could be different.
Tell me about your father's family, his origins.
Well, his origins are very humble. Generations and generations of very poor peasants, peasants of Georgia, which means Asian people, though Christian, Asian Christians for 15 centuries, like Armenians. Only his father became a worker a cobbler on the factory. His mother was purely peasant woman with strong faith, peasant woman. And I think he always had this something of that peasant background, which was in his character, certain strength, certain rigidity, certain conservatism, and tremendous love for nature and land and fresh air.
What was his mother like? Because I think that there is some... You met his mother, didn't you? And you noticed a resemblance. What was the character?
I was brought to see her when I was a girl of 8, and my brother was 12. We didn't speak Georgian, she didn't speak Russian. There were translators around. She was old, gray-haired, with bright, light eyes, kind of, her eyes were light, freckled, and she was crying and tears were streaming on her face because she was happy to see us, her grandchildren, and she was stretching on the plate some candies to us, and that was the only communication between us which was possible because we couldn't really utter anything satisfactory, but she was pleased to see us. That was the only time I saw her.
What do you think that your father's childhood was like with his mother and father?
Well, as it is known, and as he used to talk about it, it was rather... it was rather horrid, childhood of poverty, with father who was a drunk, who used to beat the rest of the household, mother and himself, and the boy, when he grew up a little bit into teenage, he used to protect mother, and one time even threw the knife at his father in protecting, so it was pretty wild, and then he had to run away and was hit by the neighbors from the furious father. It was pretty rough childhood. However, he used to say that he loved his mother always, who used to beat him too. He admitted that, but that didn't obviously make any difference. He kept certain reverence, uncles and aunts were even grandmother. They were banned from coming and visiting us in father's apartment in Kremlin. So that was an entirely different atmosphere, and the old servant, the real housekeeper of the house, who was a German from Riga, hired by my mother, a lovely woman, Karolina Thiel, was fired, and a younger person was brought in by KGB. She happened to be the relative of Beria, Beria's wife, you know, cousin of Beria's wife, kind of young woman, KGB sort of informer, shall we say, and had some rank in KGB, major or a lieutenant or something, and all the cooks and servants were attested, had military ranks in KGB. So that militarization happened on the eve of war.
Do you remember the outbreak of war?
Well, I remember it in rather what happened domestically to us, because we were all sent out of Moscow to first south to the Black Sea and then to Kuibyshev, to that town on Volga, where later the government moved, and it was like the wartime capital. The capital was moved to Kuibyshev. And of course my brothers immediately were in the army. My younger brother was in the Air Force, and my older brother was artillery officer, and he immediately left for war. So it was pretty visible. The war was pretty visibly there.
There are stories, and I don't know whether they're true, perhaps you know, about your father wondering whether to leave Moscow. Do you know?
In the fall 1941, when German army was very near to Moscow, actually in the outskirts, I think some motorcyclists were actually in the outskirts, there was a plan of moving the government to Kuibyshev, and places were prepared and residences were prepared, and I saw those, and big bomb, what are they called,
shelters
were prepared there too. But then, my father changed his mind and stayed, and one of the servants who worked then for him told about that, her story. She had to bring, to serve food, you know. They used to bring food on a heavy tray. And really very sincere admiration to her and to her character until his late years.
What about your father's training as in the priesthood? Can you tell us about that?
When we sort of revisited Russia 3 years ago with my teenage American daughter, we went to see that little shack where he was born, and then we went to see the school, the classroom, with crude wooden desks, where he sat. And my daughter asked how many languages he had to study, because she was at that time facing the problem of too many languages at once. And they told her that he had immediately, of course, everybody in Georgia, they had to know Russian, they had to study Russian, and he had also Latin and Greek in his parochial school. He was a good student. His favorite subject was, as he himself admitted, was mathematics. Not humanities, as a matter of fact, but mathematics. And then when he was in a seminary, at one time he worked at the astronomical observatory. He worked in some kind of capacity of writing down observations and something like that. He was a good student, as we know.
Why did he give up the priesthood? What do you think the priesthood had meant to him? Was it important to him later on?
I don't know how was it important when he was young. He never talked about that to me. He dropped out from the seminary, I believe, because of his other involvement in the revolutionary work and struggle, and that meant, of course, total change of philosophy.
Do you know why he became a revolutionary? Did he ever talk about it?
No. You have to understand that we were not a family where, like in Western way, parents talk very much to children and confide to them all about themselves. In fact, I have to go back to very early years when I saw my father more. When I was a teenager, or during the war, or before the war. When I was an adult, we saw each other extremely seldom, and there was very little of this reminiscence kind of a thing. Georgia at that time was, although on the outskirts, was a place of quite a revolutionary ferment, and Social Democratic Party and social democracy was very popular, taking the minds of educated students and from all classes. It always begins with the nobility and then comes to lower classes. And many Russian revolutionaries were in exile in the Caucasus, and of course they brought this, they brought Marxism in. So I think he simply answered to what was rather very typical there. It was a sign of the time.
You've said that you weren't like a Western family that reminisces, but did he ever talk to you, for instance, about his early relationship with Lenin, about what he did in the revolution?
No, he didn't touch that subject at all. I know my mother's family, the Alliluyevs, who were older revolutionaries. They were, in fact, my mother's parents knew my father since the 90s, and before my mother was even born. And they knew Lenin. They would mention once in a while him, that he was an intellectual, he was very intelligent, very polite gentleman.
Can you remember your first Red Square parade as a child?
I don't know if it was the first one. Maybe I was taken before. I suspect I was taken at the earliest stage, because that was the habit, take all children there. The one I remember was 1932, because a few days later mother died, and we were there at the parade just before that, and my brother and grandmother, and it was fun parade. And
how did life change after your mother died? Have you got any memories of that?
Well, for us children, it was really an end of an era when she died. I was 6 and a half, my brother was 11 and a half, and he certainly took it with greater pain than I. And it was total change for us. Our teachers were fired, our home studies and all that schooling and education which mother was so concerned about, all that ended. Then soon I went to school, to regular school. Then another governess was hired, which was nothing of those whom mother used to find. And then in later few years, all her sisters and brothers, you know, all Alleluia's relatives, aunts and uncles, so much beloved, they all disappeared and were sort of banned from house. So her her departure from our life was really devastating for us, and I wouldn't hesitate to say that it was also devastating for my father too.
Does your father, do you think, in retrospect, because I know it wasn't apparent at the time, but do you think your father bore any responsibility for her suicide?
I don't think he ever thought that way. He never talked, for many years, he never talked about it to me while I was too young. Prior to his death, when I was already in my 20s, he started referring to her in his biography, which official biography published in 1949. She was finally mentioned officially as a friend, as wife and close friend, which was quite a step forward, because she was just not mentioned at all, as if she didn't exist in the years prior to that. So obviously that was his attitude, otherwise they wouldn't do it. And he obviously wanted to talk about it, because he would start talking about that little pistol that her brother Paul brought to her, obviously for self-protection, kind of a, he couldn't make a better gift, sort of. He was talking about that. He would mention the book Green Hat, The Green Hat by Michael Arlen, which she read not long before that. He obviously tried to understand. He tried to figure out how it happened. He obviously was himself a person of great self-control and a not emotional person who couldn't do things like that himself. And she was more of artistic nature, more emotional, more bound to be in the moods of this and that. And in any case, I think he somehow tried to cope with it and tried to understand her in the later years.
Why? What happened with the outbreak of war? Let's go to that point and see what. First of all, I suppose, perhaps chronologically, I should ask you. When did you start to realize that people were going missing whom you knew?
Well, that was in the 30s. That was, of course, 38, 37, 36, because in our family, our uncles and aunts, they were the first who disappeared. I, as a child, I could see them missing, my aunt's husband, aunt and uncle Svanidze, both of them disappeared from sight. Then later, closer to the war time, when the war was already broke in Europe,